let's start with the picture around trust. Here's the results of a Gallup poll that is done not every year, but almost every year, in which they ask the same question every year. And as a result, you can see trends over time. And that's, to me, one of the most reliable uses of public opinion polling, is when you can see the same question asked over time and you can see a trend. So here's a very obvious one. Please tell me how much confidence you have yourself in newspapers. A great deal, quite a lot, some, or very little. And the figures I put here are the total for a great deal or quite a lot. So in 1979, you can see 51% of the people had a great deal of confidence, a lot of confidence in newspapers. And that's been steadily dropping to 20% in 2016. That's a pretty serious drop. Here's a similar question charted over time. This is Gallup. The dark green line is Republicans. The middle line is independents, many of whom are conservatives who don't even want to identify as Republicans because they're more conservative than the Republican Party. And the light green line is Democrats. And this is asking how much trust do you have in the news media. And as you can see, among Republicans, 52% in 1998, down to 14% in 2016. That's a pretty serious drop in trust. Here's the same question asked for television news. As you may know, the cable era in television news begins around 1991 with CNN and the Gulf War. 1993, 46%, a lot of confidence in television news, and then 2016 down to 21. So when you have changes that dramatic that are steady over time, something is going on there. Now, it is complicated by one fact, which is that even though people say they have less confidence in the media, when you ask them what news sources they use, they tend to say that they have a lot of confidence in the sources they use, but they don't like the media. So it's very similar to people having trust in their congressperson, but they hate Congress. You know what I mean? So you have to keep that in mind. But when people say they don't trust the media, they mean something. And when numbers decline in predictable fashion like that, then something is going on. There's a different way of looking at the question. This is Gallup asking how much trust do you have in different important key institutions in American life? And as you can see, the military is the most trusted institution in American life. This is the dark green, the great deal of trust. The light green is quite a lot. And so different institutions are trusted in different ways. The military has about 73% trusting it a lot or quite a lot. The police, more like 56%. The presidency, 36%. And then way down here, television, newspapers, at about 20 and 18%. And the only institutions less trusted are big business like Wall Street and Congress, which is at the bottom. So that's something to keep in mind. That's the trust picture for institutions generally. A few weeks ago, a remarkable letter was published by Mexican writers and journalists to their American colleagues, to the people who do the same work in the United States. And they wrote this letter because during a period of chaos and the wars between drug gangs and the incredible violence in Mexico against journalists, against police, against judges, against anyone who was trying to uphold the law. During that period, which is not completely over but has quieted quite a bit, the American press tried to support Mexican journalists who were often being kidnapped and killed just for trying to report the news by doing a lot of reporting on Mexico from the United States. And very often, the Mexican journalists would read what was going on in their own country by following the American press. And they wanted to express their appreciation to American journalists for the help that they had given the Mexican press during this period in Mexico. And they wrote this letter a few weeks ago, and here's the way they ended it. "You have stood with us during the darkest hours of press freedom in Mexico. And although we never could believe this day would come, we now stand with you." Why did they say this? Because in their view, and in my view, this is one of the darkest times for a free press as a check on power in the United States history since World War I. World War I, we had massive government censorship, massive government propaganda. So as a scholar, as a writer about journalism, to me, this is the darkest time for the American press as a check on power since World War I. The Mexican writers and journalists felt the same way. That's why they sent this letter. I shared this letter several times on my Twitter feed. I have a lot of people who follow me on Twitter. It's the only thing I've ever shared on Twitter since 2008 in which dozens, maybe more than 100 people said, after they read it, "This made me cry." That doesn't happen very often. So I'm going to shift now to explain why are they saying this, and why am I calling this the darkest period for the American press as a check on power since World War I. Let's look at some of the reasons for that conclusion. Well, the first is that journalists today are operating in a low-trust environment, not just for themselves, but as we saw in the previous chart, for all institutions, for all leaders. And these people, the leaders of our major institutions, are the same people who appear in the news. Right now, this week, for example, Congress is in the news all the time. Right? This is a big week in Congress with the attempted passage of the health care bill. But Congress is at 6%. And so the very fact that the news is about leaders and institutions who are themselves not trusted makes people kind of not trusted in. So journalists are operating in a low trust environment for themselves, but also for other institutions. There's been an economic crisis in the news business since the rise of the internet. It has to do basically with the transformation of advertising, the decline of the advertising business, and the takeover of that business by Google and Facebook. And because of this economic crisis in the news business, we have newsrooms with half, a third of the reporters they once had, going from 800 reporters to 200, going from 100 reporters to 20. And of course, when you do that, the result is a thinned out product. And when you have a thinner product, people feel less of a need for it. They fall out of the habit of reading it. And this is extremely important at the local level, because at the local level is where people begin to develop a habit of reading the news. And it's also kind of the laboratory in which people develop trust in journalism. They learn why a good journalist plugged into his or her community can help you lead a better life. It's from local news and local journalism that people develop news habits and also trust. And when the product is thinned out, people just decide they don't need it anymore. And as they decide they don't need it anymore, the economic crisis gets worse. Advertising and subscription revenue go down even more. And you have a cycle that's spiraling into oblivion. On the political right in this country, conservative movement, there is, and I want to make sure you understand this, an organized campaign to discredit the profession of journalism. What I mean by organized is, first of all, it's led by the figure at the top, the President of the United States, who is constantly explaining to his followers not only that they should mistrust the media, but if they hate the news media, that is justified. And he's even gone so far as to say that the media is the enemy of the American people, which is an extreme phrase and a disturbing concept. So you have leadership from the top, then at the bottom you have an army of online trolls and activists who are constantly beating up on journalists, trying to shout down their reporting, trolling them and harassing them, and persuading other people not to trust them. So you have sort of an army of online trolls at the base, you have the president at the top, and in the middle, you have talk radio, Breitbart, Matt Drudge, and other news institutions that kind of talk from the top and connect to the bottom. So that's what I mean by an organized campaign to discredit mainstream journalism, and it has become part of Republican Party politics. It's part of the coalition that holds the party together. As a result of that and a lot of other things, about a quarter to a third of the electorate is effectively lost to mainstream journalism, in the sense that they don't interact with it at all, except to hate it, to project resentment on it. They watch Fox, they rely on alternative news sources, often found online or through Facebook, and they reject what the established press reports. Now, nobody knows how big this component of the electorate is. I'm estimating it's somewhere between 25% and a third, but nobody really knows. What I mean by lost is they are so mistrustful and so out of the habit of accepting what's reported in the mainstream news media that there is effectively no way to speak to them. They're not there on the other end of the communication channel. For professionals in the American press, the events of 2016, the election of 2016, were a devastating blow. But no season of serious reform has followed from those events. This is the one area that I can think of where I agree with Steve Bannon. He has said that the election showed that the American press is kind of lost. And I agree with that. It's not just the fact that they made a bad prediction and thought Hillary Clinton was going to win and were shocked when Donald Trump won. That's part of it. It's also the fact that the political press in the United States invests quite a lot in its ability to tell us what's likely to happen. That's what horse race journalism is. Horse race journalism, horse race coverage of an election is about who's going to win. Who's likely to win? Who's ahead? How are they winning? What is their strategy for winning? The whole thing is organized around winning. And when you're wrong about who is going to win, it's not just that you made a bad prediction, it's that you invested a lot in that prediction. On top of that, the election results clearly showed that the American press, especially headquartered in New York and Washington, is in some fundamental way out of touch with the electorate. It doesn't understand it the way it has to in order to report about the country as a whole. On top of that, I know journalists, very talented, young person who reported on the campaign. I was on a panel with her the day after the election, in New York, which was not a good day to be in New York, by the way. And she explained to me that she woke up crying, not because her candidate lost. I don't know who her candidate was. I assume she probably didn't vote for Trump. But she woke up crying because she in her mind, she said, everything we did was wasted, in the sense that we tried to warn the country about somebody who was not ready to be president, who didn't have the temperament, who didn't have the knowledge, who didn't have the discipline, who didn't have the truth-telling to be president, and none of it mattered. So she felt like her work was being ignored, and in a way, that's what Steve Bannon was saying, was that the electorate ignored you, therefore, we don't need to hear from you anymore. You should, this is how he put it, shut up and listen. I think there's something to that. But, and this is the point of my slide, even though it was a devastating result, and there was a lot of reflection anxiety after the election, a lot of, whoa, we have to look at what we did here. The press hasn't fundamentally reformed in any way. It hasn't changed how it reports on politics. It hasn't actually introduced any radical changes, even though there was this devastating blow. Journalists still rely on an outdated model of political coverage, which tries to reveal to us the inside game and turn us into connoisseurs of our own bamboozlement. And here's what I mean. I think years ago, the American press took a wrong turn. I don't know exactly when it happened, but sometime within the last 25 years, the political press, the national level, but also this happened at the local level too, took a wrong turn in the sense that it started to report on politics through the eyes of the professionals in it who are responsible for winning elections, running campaigns, manipulating us, figuring out how to spread messages, how to target voters. And these professionals, the handlers, the strategists, the pollsters, are the people you see sometimes on cable news introduced, if you ever watch news on cable, introduced as a Democratic strategist, crystal ball. You know the kind of person I'm talking about? And relying on people whose profession is to reach and move and manipulate the electorate, I think forced journalists into bad habits and weakened their connection to the public. So, for example, when you hear, as you often will on CNN, when it has its roundtable on to discuss today's events, something like, how do you think this is going to play with white working class voters? You know the language I'm talking about? Can you hear this in your head? How is this going to play with white working class voters? That's inviting us to look at the electorate through the eyes of the people who are paid to manipulate it. It's not actually trying to engage white working class voters. It's talking about them. And this is the wrong turn that I think political journalists made. They tried to reveal the inside game to us and make themselves experts in how you win elections and run campaigns and capture nominations. And that's another reason why Bannon was so right when he said, hey, you guys blew it in 2016. It's a well-known pattern. Money, talent, investment, prestige, and opportunity in journalism are increasingly concentrated in expensive cities on the coast, New York, Washington, Los Angeles, to some degree Chicago, San Francisco. And the career path in journalism you work in small towns if you have to start off, but you're always trying to jump to bigger markets. And one of the results of that career pattern is that there's a tendency for people to do Washington Post journalism in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, in order to get the attention of the editors in Washington and eventually jump there. You see what I mean? As opposed to sinking roots deeply into the communities where you are and doing journalism for those communities. Now, that's not entirely true. It's a tendency. It's a dangerous tendency. So journalism has this coastal problem where a lot of the talent, investment, prestige, money is available on the coast, and that leaves the center of the country kind of hollowed out. In addition to that, hate speech against journalists as a class is a routine practice for Mr. Trump. It helps him mobilize his supporters and elude checks on his power. When I say hate speech, I mean that literally. Hate speech is when you try to whip up hate against a group because they are members of that group, right? That's what hate speech is. And in my view, there is no doubt that our current president practices hate speech against journalists as a group. When you call that group the enemy of the American people, that's about as far as you can go. That's close to saying that they are traitors to the country, which is as far as you can go. And calling what journalists do fake news is part of that. Making a feature of his rallies, the whipping up in the room, in the arena, of antagonism and resentment towards journalists is part of that. Pointing at the people who are there to report on the rally and basically instructing his supporters to project their resentment on those people in the room, that's part of it as well. So when you have that happening from the top, when the president is the leader of that movement, that generates a lot of cultural resentment against the press. And it's very hard to counter that. I remember once, like a few weeks ago, or maybe it was about a month ago, Mr. Trump held a rally in Florida. I remember there was this moment, I was watching it, where he said, the cameras won't show how many people are here. And as soon as he said that, the CNN camera panned around and showed how many people are here, right? So that's the kind of situation we're in, where the media is trying to do its job. It is showing how many people are there, and Trump is insisting that it's not. And so it kind of forces a choice. Well, who do I trust more? And that's why those figures I showed you at the beginning matter. You know, it's hard to have a fact-based debate when the leader of the free world observes no distinction between true and false and cannot be successfully fact-checked. And what I mean by cannot be successfully fact-checked is not that you can't write fact-checks about Donald Trump's statements. You can, as happens every day. He's probably the most fact-checked public figure in the world, and very frequently the press finds in a single speech or interview, you know, 15 to 20 statements of fact that are just plain wrong. It happened just yesterday with an interview in Time magazine, which was all about, doesn't it bother you that people say you're never telling the truth? And he says, what do you mean? But when I say he can't be successfully fact-checked, what I mean is, fact-checkers like the Washington Post, Glenn Kessler, will tell you that all political figures lie. All presidents shade the truth. It is utterly common for people in power to try and get away with lies, evasions, spin, manipulations to help them accomplish their political goals. That is like the most normal thing in politics there can be. But in the past, when they were called on a specific factual statement that was unsupportable, and the press got at them for saying that, most of the time, political figures would change what they were doing. They would change the statement so that it was kind of sort of true, or they would just stop saying that. So they would react in some way. They wouldn't necessarily admit, "You're right, you got me, I was lying." They wouldn't say that, but they would alter their behavior in response to the fact check because it was a form of pressure. Just like there's political pressure, there's press pressure. And so what's different about Trump is he doesn't care. He literally does not care if what he is saying is true. And he will repeat it endlessly, even though it has been completely fact-checked. That's different. It's very hard to know what to do about a pattern like that. So it's hard to have a fact-based debate when you have the leader of the free world who doesn't care with whether what he's saying is true. And without a fact-based debate, why do we need journalists? This is a problem. Whoops. This is the hardest point, most troubling observation I had, especially for anyone in this room who's a professor. How many professors we have here? Okay. For reasons we do not understand, reality itself seems to have become a weaker constraint in the politics of the Western democracy. This is something where I think our profession, professors, political scientists, people who study history, people who study journalism, I don't think we know why this is happening. But it's happening in more than one country where, and there are certain terms that have emerged to try and describe this. I don't like these terms very much, so I don't use them. But there are terms like post-truth society and a post-fact world. That doesn't tell us very much, but it's trying to name this thing. I don't think anyone knows why reality has become a weak constraint. When I say weak constraint, it just means political actors feel free to ignore it. Like the evidence for climate change, for example. I don't think we know why this is happening, but it is happening, and it's, again, if we can just ignore reality, if it's not much of a constraint at all, then a lot of what journalists do becomes irrelevant, right? In an atmosphere of chronic culture war, that's liberals, conservatives fighting endlessly about who controls our institutions, that's culture war. Watergate-style journalism increasingly inflames and polarizes rather than alerting the system that something is awry. My political education began with Watergate in 1973. I was in high school. And I had nothing to do in the summer. In those days, there were like 6 TV channels. And they all had soap operas on, except for PBS. And PBS was playing these hearings in Washington, which were digging into the Watergate scandal. This is the first time I ever paid any attention to politics. And the most remarkable thing for me as a 17-year-old at the time was the Democrats and the Republicans on this committee in the Senate both wanted to find out what was going on with Nixon and Watergate. They were equally committed to finding the facts, finding the truth. And when a Nixon aide revealed one day that there was a taping system in the White House, which was amazing, I mean, we could listen to what they were saying, everybody on the committee agreed we must have the tapes. Of course we have to have the tapes, so we're gonna get the tapes. And as a 17-year-old, this was really impressive to me. Wow, democracy really works. And I had another insight, which is, if I follow this story, I'll know as soon as anyone else knows whether Nixon is a crook. And I thought that was pretty cool. And you could follow the story if you watch the hearing. People in journalism talk about Woodward and Bernstein being like the heroes of Watergate. I didn't experience that way. I didn't know who they were. I didn't read the Washington Post. I never learned about them until 10 years later. For me, the heroes of Watergate were the people in Congress who wanted to find out what was going on. So investigative journalism is supposed to do that. It's supposed to alert the system that something needs correction here. Something needs investigation. But today, because we have this condition of culture war, it's much more likely that investigative journalism is just going to feed the culture war even more. You know what I mean? It's going to just make people more upset. Didn't used to be that way. Another thing that's happening now is that the power to inform and the whole relationship with people seeking information is gradually decoupling itself from the news media and connecting itself to Facebook and Google and Apple News and other platforms where people actually go to access the news. And the tech industry is very good at creating these platforms, but it doesn't want any part of the fourth estate press functions that journalists were once happy to take on themselves. And so Facebook has the power because it has the relationship with consumers of the news, but it doesn't want to be a press organization. It doesn't want to be a media company. It doesn't want to have editorial responsibility. That's a problem. With timid leadership and a thin institutional structure, the American press cannot easily organize itself to fight back or resist the designs of power. The press is kind of an institution, but unlike the military, which is organized to act as a unit and attack if need be, and is disciplined in that way, the press as an institution has almost no discipline because there are no leaders that are recognized by all as the leaders. And there are no institutions of central command. And it's not very easy to get journalists to stop doing things that are bad habits and get them to do things that would be smarter habits. So the phrase I like to use for this is, they're a herd of independent minds. A herd of independent minds. They have all the worst parts of a herd, and that they all tend to go in the same direction, but they all think of themselves as individuals, and because they think of themselves as individuals, it's very difficult to get them to change what they're doing. So in that sense, it's a weak institution because it's hard to get journalists on the same page. So for example, when early in the Trump administration, senior administration officials go to the press and say, we want to brief you about this executive order, but you can't use our names. Think about that. Why would a government official want to brief the press about something the administration did and say, here's what we're doing, here's why it's a great idea, but don't use my name? Nonetheless, the press accepted these conditions, went to the briefing, and quoted these officials who we still don't know who they were, and what these officials said anonymously was, we're doing a great job. This rollout of this executive order was perfect. It was fantastic. But don't use my name. That doesn't make any sense. But because it's a weak institution with a weak institutional structure, it's hard for the press to resist these things. So it can be acted on, but it's hard for it to act. With Trump in power, Mr. Trump in power, there's a surplus of eventfulness. He tends to keep everyone in a constant state of alarm. Too much news. The temptation to shut it off is high. Before Trump, the way presidents and candidates tried to control the news media was by making as little news as possible, except for the one message you wanted to deliver that day. That was normal behavior in campaigns and in the presidency. You only want to make news around the one message you want to push that day. And that became normal. That's the way journalists thought Washington worked. Trump, Mr. Trump, obliterates that. He makes too much news in a day. It's not, it wouldn't even be correct to say he steps on his message. It's like he's stomping all over various messages at once, and there's just a lot to report, a lot to focus on. Some of it is really important. Some of it might be only important for a day. Some of it is completely misleading. A lot of it is chaos. And under conditions like that, it's hard for journalists to sort of order our attention, but it's also a big temptation for readers, viewers, listeners to just give up. Within the press, the most common attitude towards what should we do about all this is this kind of fundamentalism. Just do the job. The job is the job. The job hasn't changed. Just do the job. If you say that in an American newsroom, 90% of the people will raise their hand and say, I agree with that guy. But what if the job has changed? What if just doing the job doesn't actually work? Problem. Okay, so let's get to the question I know is on your minds. What do we do about all this? So, I want to explain to you 9 steps that I think would start, and I want to emphasize start, to address the problems of trust in American journalism. They're not a solution. They're just directions it would be smart to go in if you wanted to do something about this. That's all. So the first is, I believe, lots of journalists disagree with me, lots of people who are readers, viewers, listeners to the news disagree with me. Lots of you probably disagree with me. But I believe that the claim, we don't have a philosophy, we don't have a point of view, we don't have a stake, we don't have any assumptions, we don't have an agenda here. We're just giving you the news so you should believe it because it's just facts, which is sometimes called the view from nowhere in broadcast news, the voice of God approach. I believe that that claim, we don't have a point of view, we're just giving you the news, is increasingly inviting mistrust. It invites people to mistrust the media because they don't believe it. And if people don't believe you when you say, I don't have an agenda here, I'm just giving you the news, they're not going to believe you if you say, no, really, I'm serious, I don't have an agenda, I'm just giving you the news. You can't get out of that loop by insisting even more strongly on what is sometimes called objectivity. And so, I believe the only way out of that box is for journalists to begin to learn to say to us, here's where I'm coming from. Here's where I'm coming from. It's not the view from nowhere. It's not the voice of God. But I do have some starting points. I do have some things I'm trying to accomplish here. We stand for something. We do have some priorities. And here is what they are. And with that shift from voice of God to view from nowhere, you allow people to decide themselves how much mistrust they should place in your reporting, what kind of discount rate they should use for your information. So somehow the press has to move from view from nowhere to here's where we're coming from, while at the same time maintaining very high standards of verification. Verification is, did this really happen? How do we know? Where are the facts? Where's the proof? Where's the evidence? So the combination of here's where we're coming from and very high standards of verification, meaning we don't say it unless we have some reason to know it's true, might get the press out of this box. Another thing journalists need to do is they need to start identifying for their readers, viewers, listeners, these are our priorities. These are the stories that we're going to focus on and concentrate on. These are the things we think are really important. And you could, should be able to actually go to WashingtonPost.com or Dallas Morning News and find a list of current reporting priorities, because that too tells you where they're coming from. These things go hand in hand, though, with being willing to defend your reporting when it is solid. The best news organizations in the United States are now learning, like ProPublica, New York Times, Washington Post, that when their reporting is attacked, especially when it's attacked for political reasons, not because it actually has any weaknesses in it, but because people don't like what it's saying, you have to respond. And you have to respond with facts. And do it publicly. And tell critics why they're wrong. And show readers, viewers, and listeners what information you used to create that report in the first place. And be very aggressive about that. The most powerful claim that a journalist can make on trust is when they are able to say, don't believe us, look for yourself. Meaning, if I can point you to the data that I used to draw the conclusions I made in my report, and you can look yourself at the data and check up on my work, that builds trust. Don't believe me? Here's the data. Don't believe me? Look at the numbers yourself. Don't believe me? Here's the interview we did. Check it out. Don't believe us? Here's the materials we use to come to these conclusions. The more that journalists can shift to that model, as opposed to, trust us, we're CBS. We're professionals, right? It's different. Don't believe us? Look for yourself. It's different than, we're professionals. Shifting to that model would help. Something you're seeing more and more now, and I think it's very positive development, especially on a breaking news story, like this week we had the breaking news story in London of a terrorist attack, right? What happens is there's a lot of confusion at the beginning, a lot of rumor, you hear a lot of things, some of them turn out to be wrong, and a very good way for journalists to behave in that situation is to be very clear from the beginning, continually updated with, here's what we know, and here's what we don't know. And while that seems like incredibly commonsensical, and like, of course, why they should do that, it actually was a hesitation in professional journalism for a long time to say, here's what we don't know. Because they wanted to sustain the illusion that we know everything. Here's what we know, here's what we don't know. That can really help. Also, what can help? When you have published your report, you simply ask people, what did we miss? What did we leave out? What did we not capture properly? We're listening. Tell us, what did we miss? And if you are serious about the question and listening to the answers, that can inspire the next round of reporting. What did we miss? Tell us. It's increasingly common for big news organizations or and even small community news organizations to say to their users, help us investigate. Meaning, you have knowledge we need. We have powers you don't have. If you help us investigate, together we can make a stronger combination. So, for example, ProPublica.org, which is a nonprofit investigative newsroom in New York, national news organization, very effective in many ways, put out a call to its members and fans, asking them to forward to ProPublica what Republican congressmen were promising their constituents about the healthcare bill, because they wanted to see what people in Congress were saying about it so they could fact check it. So they said to people who live in those districts, send us what your congressman is sending you so we can put it all together and report on it. That's help us investigate. When people do that, and they do help, and then they see the work that comes out of it, the report that comes out of that call out, that builds trust. I think it would be really interesting and very effective for news organizations to start putting at the end of the articles that they run, especially the big investigations, how much it costs to actually do this. Because that would help people see how much work goes into real journalism. Also, some kinds of articles that appear, reports that appear, don't cost very much at all. And that would be interesting too. So it isn't done now. I've almost never see it done, but it can be very powerful. Last year, Mother Jones, which is an investigative magazine based in San Francisco, published this really fascinating, award-winning piece of journalism in which one of their writers got a job as a prison guard in Louisiana and worked for a year in a prison in Louisiana that was a private prison. You know, it was run as a business on behalf of the state, because private prisons are a controversial thing. And he wanted to see what it was really like to work in such a place. And they ran the story. It was very dramatic, very interesting, I think 4,000 words. And then about a month later, the editor ran a piece that was titled, "This Isn't Working." And she explained that they spent like about $150,000 on this one article. That's what it cost to do it. And it had made something like $5,000 in advertising. You know what I mean? And so she wrote to her readers saying, look, this isn't working. We're doing the journalism. It got read. A lot of people read it. A lot of people loved it. A lot of people thanked us for it. But in the online and advertising market, which is dominated by Facebook and Google, it made $5,000. It cost us $150,000. Like, this isn't working. One of the results of that was a flood of donations to Mother Jones. So maybe being upfront with how much the journalism costs would start to address the economic crisis. Finally, I think it's really interesting that more and more news organizations are turning to membership, saying, don't just be a reader, don't just be a listener, don't just be a user of our journalism, become a member. And what they mean by membership, part of it is give us money so that we don't have to rely on advertising and clickbait. But part of membership is also, you know things we don't know. You can help us investigate. You can collaborate with us. And I think there's a lot of potential in that. So, these are my steps. This is just summarizing things that I think journalists could do that could start to address trust. This is where we're coming from. Here's our current priorities. If you attack our reporting, we will respond. Don't believe us. Check for yourself. Here's what we know, what we don't know. Hey, what did we miss? Hey, help us investigate. Here's what this story cost. And become a member. Okay, one more slide and then I'm done. I call this the big listen. It goes back to what Bannon said about the press. I think journalists really do need to filter out into the country, into their communities, and start listening to what people's troubles are. Troubles are the things that are bothering them in their lives. Things that they worry about every day. The things they talk to their spouses about or their kids. Those are troubles. I think journalists have to get much better at listening to people's troubles, so that they understand where those troubles connect or don't connect to public issues, the kinds of issues that get fought out in the campaign. And they somehow have to listen well enough so that they understand that connection better than the political system. That's the only way they're going to recover trust. And I don't think that's easy. I don't know exactly how that is done. I'm just pointing them in that direction. That would be a good thing to start doing. Okay, thanks for listening. Now. Who has a question or comment they want to start with? Yes, sir. Oh yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
One of the scenes that stuck out in my mind was when they were doing the press conference and they did a leak about the B3 bomber. They were like, what's the B3 bomber? And it pulled all the media attention away from the really important matter that was happening to the president. Do you think the media's like desperation for that next big news story kind of pulls everyone's focus away from things that affect them a lot more?
Yeah, this is a huge problem. It used to be like that with Wag the Dog, where you'd have a story that was really important, and then what we now call a shiny object, right, dangled in front of the press. And that would distract. Now we're in a more complicated, even more difficult situation, where there are so many shiny objects at once that nobody actually knows what's a distraction from what. And it's really hard to tell with everything that's going on, like the Russia story and healthcare and massive tax cuts and huge deregulation and no more EPA and a dozen other things at once, where the scene is so chaotic and there's no easy way, as I said earlier, to order our attention. So some people believe that Mr. Trump and his aides are like wizards at creating distractions, and they're really good at it, and everything that the news media is talking about is a distraction from something larger that we don't even know about yet. I hear this all the time. People tell me this all the time. I don't really buy that. I think that their method is much closer to chaos. And the imposition of chaos on the political system and the attention system might be deliberate, it might just be they're incompetent, it might be a response to the president's own narcissism, I don't know. But chaos seems to be almost like a method. And part of it is a chaotic news system and an attention dynamic where we don't know what to pay attention to. So yeah, that's a big problem. Yes.
How would you say journalism on like entertainment such as People and Cosmopolitan affects our trust in actual political news?
Could you repeat the first part? I didn't hear
like,
you.
Journalism on entertainment, like this movie stars and like people who are famous, affects our opinion on actual political news.
Yes, I could have had a slide about that. I did in an earlier version of this talk. The values of entertainment are fine in themselves, but they become a problem when they invade other spheres, and those other spheres get organized around the logic of entertainment. So this happens in television news a lot, where the decisions that are made don't make any sense in journalistic logic, but they do make a lot of sense in entertainment logic. So an example would be on CNN, the people who are brought on as strategists or commentators or talking heads very often don't really have freedom of thought, freedom of speech. They are representing a fixed point of view that's always the same no matter what the facts are. That doesn't make a lot of sense as a journalistic decision. Having somebody like that on the air doesn't make a lot of sense. But from an entertainment point of view, it makes a lot of sense. It's total sense. Because you have predictable characters who are going to predictably conflict with one another and generate certain tension each time. And as a kind of director, you can sort of like script the show if you know what people are going to say. Journalistically, it's a lot better if you don't know what people are going to say. So very often, the appearance of these very predictable talking heads is more like a sitcom. It's more like Cheers or something like that, because we have regular characters we can identify and we know what they're going to do. So the eruption of entertainment values into news spaces is part of why people don't trust the news. And another example of that, probably a more current one, is just the rise of what we now call clickbait. And clickbait headlines and the bad faith that's implied in a clickbait headline, meaning the headline is really juicy and when you read the story, there's actually nothing there, you know what I mean? That causes mistrust. And dependence on that system is making trust a lot worse, which is one of the reasons I think membership is good. If we can get people to pay more directly for news rather than indirectly through the clickbait and advertising system, we can make a start on restoring trust. Yes, sir.
This reminds me of the this ratings game and the quest for ratings and the demonization of the press as being liberal and so forth. I see a lot of times, in especially radio and TV, this attempt to go out of the way to present both sides, and it sets up this false equivalency,
right,
where you have, you know, this one speaks and this one speaks, and they move on, but one's just lying, and the other's, you know, at least fact-based. But there seems to be no balance in there. And you see more and more of this. And I almost think it's the journalist or maybe the media company or whatever is afraid, you know, when you have Fox News being the leader, you know, the more people watch Fox News than any other, or used to be, I don't know what the current rating situation is, that they're trying to prove that they're not liberal or prove that, you know.
Right.
So sometimes the news is liberal. I mean, the answers are liberal. And they're trying to avoid that just because they don't want to alienate the viewers they're trying to attract when they're trying to get that wider demographic. And I see that even in newspaper reporting, for that matter. And one other thing I wanted to mention, when we talk about the media is not monolithic. You have, you know, there's a big difference in newspaper reporting and broadcast journalists. The ratings are everything in different ways. But there are a lot of truth-telling journalists out there, and have been for decades, that are dedicated to reporting news objectively and getting the story straight and doing it ethically and doing it right. And there are people, you can find the truth. It's not being, you know, I'm sure there are many things competing for the truth right now. And people these days almost have to learn to triangulate information just so they can verify things. But there are certain sources, certain reporters that you can tell them, you know? And if they get it wrong, they'll correct it. And I don't know that many people understand that, or I mean, there's a big difference in for instance, the president is getting his information from something like Breitbart or he watches Fox and Friends every morning.
Yeah, well, I think, and I have a lot to add to that because I agree with most all of it, but one thing that we could do, people on the receiving end could do to increase trust in the media is to stop using this term, the media. It doesn't actually help us very much at all. Everyone hates the media, including me, but the media doesn't have an address. Like, you can't go anywhere and touch it. You can't, there's no boss of the media. It's not an institution that we can actually reform. And if people, instead of talking about the media, railing against the media, projecting hate onto the media, blaming the media, realize that this construct is sort of just a fiction, like a bucket for our own fears and resentments, that would help a lot. Another thing, in response to what you said, it's not just that there are a lot of journalists who try to find out what's actually happening and give us a report that is free from any particular point of view. There are people who try to do that. There, some of them are very good at it. But there are also a lot of journalists who right now, just like our military, are placing themselves in dangerous situations in order to tell us the truth. And that's something I actually should have included in my list. I think the American press should be much more forward and clear about all of the people who right now are in dangerous situations, like in Syria, or in Africa, or in Afghanistan, just to report the truth. And every year around the world, including in the United States, journalists are killed doing their job. That's not true for a lot of other professions. Not many lawyers are killed doing their job. So why are they doing it? Not to, because they're trying to propagandize us with their point of view, but because they actually believe in the importance of reporting. So I think that idea that not only are there honest journalists out there, but some of them put their lives on the line for the public is something that should be emphasized more. Yes, in the back.
Going along with what the gentleman said in your response, can you say a little bit more about how you would want, or how you would recommend that we speak about the media? Because you just said it is an institution that cannot be reformed, and isn't it a little bit problematic to think about our media industry or the media industry as something that cannot be reformed?
Well, the reason I say it cannot be reformed is not that there aren't ways to improve journalism, but that it can't be done through something called the media, because the media, as I said, doesn't have an address, doesn't have a leadership structure like the military does, right? You can't pass a law that says the media can no longer do this. That First Amendment prevents that. You can't regulate it. That's how we change institutions a lot. How do we change schools? We say, well, you have to have facilities for the disabled if you're in public school. That's the law, right? You can't do that with the media. So there are lots of ways in which you can't reform the media. I'm not saying we should throw up our hands. I'm just saying that's not the entry point. So what is the entry point? Well, it's individual news organizations. So it's like the Dallas Morning News, that's an institution you can talk to. ProPublica.org, you can talk to that person, to those people, right? And so our attention, our efforts at change should focus on our relationships with individual news companies, newsrooms, and the people who lead those newsrooms. Because when you go to the Dallas Morning News, I happen to know the editor of that newspaper, that's why I'm using it, there's a guy there who's supposed to lead that organization, right? And he cares a lot about this question of trust. And I saw him in Miami like 3 weeks ago, and he was kind of like very distressed himself at how difficult it is to breach the culture war gap that he has in his own community, right? So that's a person, we can talk to that person. So that's what I meant. Yes?
I was wondering in regard to the first step of the solution that you're proposing, considering that the mainstream media, also individual news agencies, are governed by this idea of the marketplace of free ideas, the liberal model of news media, can you entertain a situation where an individual news agency uses this idea that already governs their practice to advance the first step of your solution, where it said, you know, this is just another idea in the free marketplace that you're advocating here. Instead of trying to play by the rules that govern that kind of constrain them.
When you say play by the rules, what rules are you referring to there?
Specifically for mainstream media, free marketplace of ideas, the idea of objectivity.
Yeah.
Is almost,
yeah, I think that's happening. For example, ProPublica.org, very interesting organization. I refer to them a lot because they address some of these problems in the way they organize themselves. When you go to their about page, they don't say, well, we're just news, you know, we have a point of view. Instead, what they say is, we do accountability journalism. That's the only kind of journalism we do. And what they mean by accountability journalism is holding powerful people and powerful institutions accountable for what they say and do. And we do investigative journalism that digs into, are they really doing what they say they do? So one of the big investigations they did in the last couple of years was of the Red Cross. The Red Cross. Red Cross is a charity. It's a do-gooders organization. It helps out in major disasters like Hurricane in Haiti, right? But the Red Cross accepts a lot of money from people and says, here's what we do with the money. So ProPublica did an investigation into how does the Red Cross actually spend its money? And how much of the money that we give to it in an emergency actually goes to the people who need it? That's a good question, right? The Red Cross is powerful because it has this role that is now expected of it. When disaster strikes, you call the Red Cross, right? They raise a lot of money. They're a big organization. So ProPublica's thing is, we find out if you're actually doing what you say you're doing. That's not the same thing as we don't have a point of view, right? And they are generating support for their mission because they have a strong sense of mission. So my last point there, number 9 of my 9 suggestions, was membership. If news organizations are going to say, become a member, they're going to have to make a much stronger statement than view from nowhere, just news. They're going to have to say, why should I support you? They're going to have to answer that question. You see what I mean? Yes?
So going kind of to accountability, not so much being like consumers in the media, but being politicians in the media, obviously what the media is doing right now with the current administration is not working in terms of accountability.
True. Well, right now, and this is something I think about every day, like literally hours a day. It's kind of sick, actually. Right now, I don't think it is possible for the press to hold the Trump administration accountable, because the Trump administration is willing to do things that no previous administration was willing to do. So an example would is what I said about fact-checking. Most previous presidents, White Houses, when they were fact-checking, it was kind of unanimous that what they said was wrong. They stopped saying it, or they adjusted what they were saying. The Trump administration not only doesn't do that, it doubles down on what it said that has already been fact-checked. And I can't emphasize this enough, even though I've said it before, and I can see in your faces it's not getting through. The president doesn't care if what he's saying is true. That is unusual, and I'll tell you why it's unusual. I wrote a piece about this at my current site right now. It's the cover piece of pressthink.org. Since the Cold War, American presidents have had a very strange power in their hands, which is they can blow up the world. You know what I mean? We have the power, as a nuclear power, to blow up, let's say, Western civilization. And it took a while for people to become kind of accustomed to that fact, because it's a very strange power to give somebody. And it literally is one of the powers the president has, in the sense that, as you probably know, anywhere the president goes, the nuclear controls go with him. You know that, right? And there's always somebody there with them, like in a little suitcase, so that if he has to give the order, he can give the order. So because the American president, starting with Truman, had this incredible power, which is like godlike. It's not like a power that we give to a person. It's not like running a corporation or running a government. It's a power over civilization itself. The White House and the president began to do certain things to assure us that this power to blow up the world was in safe hands. And so that's part of the reason why the president is never off the grid, even for a second. The president is never alone, even for a second. The president always has trusted advisors around him. The president has access to the best information in the world. The president every day starts his day with an intelligence briefing about possible threats in the world. The president doesn't fly off the handle for no reason. The president is calm. The president is careful. The president knows what he's talking about. All of these demands on the person in the job are partly an attempt to make us feel okay with a single person having the power to blow up the world. And that's one of the reasons why, when the president was fact-checked, the White House thought it was important to correct the record or stop saying it. Because you don't want to freak people out, you know what I mean, about their president. Trump completely obliterates this. He has a very different idea, which is not to persuade us, don't worry, the power to blow up the world is in safe hands with a safe, sober, sane, reliable person. Instead, his theory is, although it's never been spelled out, his theory is, you know what? Yeah, the president can blow up the world, and he might just do it because he's that kind of crazy, dangerous guy. So you better listen to what he says because he could, like, really, excuse the expression, fuck you up. Right? That is Trump's approach. It's impossible for me to explain how different that is from every previous president, Republican and Democrat. That's why it's not a left-right thing to me. It's a this is completely different model thing. So how does this answer your question? It doesn't, but that's why I say you can't hold this president accountable, because he doesn't agree with any of these norms of behavior that all previous presidents have obeyed. Now, so what does the press do? I think right now the only way to hold the press accountable is for journalists to, in a way, divert their attention from the White House and start focusing on Republicans in Congress. And what do they think of what the president is doing? Do they support what he said? Do they obey the norms he is trashing? Do they sign on to the fake facts that he keeps, right? And keep asking them, because that is where his system could break down. It's the only thing I can think of. You cannot hold the White House accountable. Don't even try. Or maybe it's worth trying, but don't expect it to happen.
Can I ask a follow-up question?
Yeah.
Do you think that the issue lies more with us as the electorate, like not holding, like there haven't been any consequences to Donald Trump yet? We, like, I guess in the electorate, we hear articles of, you know, he lied, this is the truth, this is the truth. I think one of the fact checkers had, like, the pants on fire.
So yeah. Well, sure, the voters are the ultimate, I mean, nobody speaks as loudly as voters do. So, yeah, I mean, that's the other way we can hold them accountable, of course, is elections. That's why we have elections. So the 2018 elections could be really important, and the 2020 elections could be really important. But that's up to the voters, that's not up to the journalists. But that's why the relationship between journalists and the electorate, which I talked about in my lecture, is so important. Yes.
Yes. Tax actions, they just couldn't wrap their head around.
Yes.
And it was more of this, you know, there's so many issues, they're all so different, you need to pick one to prioritize. How do you think, you know, because all of these polls and everything, you know, all gone wrong, do you think, or how do you think
starting to feel that they could express themselves without being labeled a racist, a bigot, a sexist, you know, for supporting a person, you know, because you can agree with the person's ideas and not, then how do you think that played into the election, but also the election as a reaction to the previous administration?
Yeah. I think it was a huge factor. I agree with that analysis. I think Hillary Clinton was a lot weaker a candidate than a lot of people thought, at least a lot of people in New York and Washington thought. That's one thing that was going on. I also think that this stifling atmosphere where you can't say certain things for fear being labeled in a certain way, I think there's something to that. I think that's real. I think that's something that people experience as a loss of freedom, which means that defeating the person who represents that would be an increase in freedom, right? And if people are going to vote, they will frequently vote for more freedom. So I do think that's a factor. I think there is such a thing as it's called on college campuses, PC. I've been teaching on college campuses for 30 years. I know it when I see it. It's real. It doesn't affect me that much. I don't often find myself, but sometimes censoring myself. It does happen. Like an example for me would be about 10 years ago, I stopped telling jokes in classrooms. I won't do it. Doesn't matter how harmless it is, but I will not even go there because the chance of somebody getting offended by whatever joke it is just too high. It's not worth the risk. So that's not a huge thing. It's not like I'm complaining about it. If I don't tell jokes, that's not really much of a loss. But what I'm trying to point out is this is not a fiction. There's something to that idea of that the cost of saying certain things had risen to an unacceptably high level, and that was really making people angry. I think there's something to that. Also, I think, and here I'm like putting on a political pundit hat, which is not really my expertise, but something I saw happen during the campaign was some voters just didn't want to vote for Hillary Clinton. They did not trust her. They did not like her. They did not believe she was in concert with their values. And they also knew about the dangers of Trump. And they kind of also knew that Trump's a little bit out there and he says lots of things that are untrue. And so they were conflicted, they were anxious about that. And that is what created the market for the demonization of Hillary Clinton, the unfair demonization of Hillary. Because if she was really bad, like the worst, like a criminal, like somebody who should be arrested, which is something Trump said, then it was okay to vote for Trump. So I think there's a connection there with the demonization of Hillary Clinton. But as I said, that's my pundit hat. That's not really has nothing to do with journalism. Yes?
I feel like there's still an elephant in the room, and it's called the fringe press. Just like we have a fringe president, mm-hmm. I think if we're all honest about our own personal news feeds and some of the political dialogue we maybe have with some of our own relatives or friends that are huge Trump supporters, they've probably forwarded some fringe press articles to you by reporters that you've never heard of, or maybe bloggers that are working out of their garages that are forwarding on misinformation that has been shared, you know, 500 times where that ProPublica verified, you know, backed
yes.
article maybe has been viewed, you know, 20 times.
Yeah.
That's what troubles me.
Yeah.
What do we do about that? Because if we really look at what's being passed around in social media among our social peers, among our colleagues that maybe have differing opinions, that misinformation is spreading like wildfire, has helped support the Trump campaign. This presidential administration will continue to do so. And so even though I'm fully backing everything that's been said today, that absolutely there needs to be reform and we need to restore trust in the American press, often a lot of this addresses the elitist press, the mainstream press. I need to know, how do we deal with the fringe press that's supporting a lot of what Trump is doing?
I know what you're talking about. I didn't include it in my slides, but I certainly could have. It's definitely part of the fabric of this problem. The way I would think of it is, fringe press is a fine term, but the way I analyze that portion of the media sphere is that it's two things at once. It's very demand driven, in the sense that there is a demand for certain things to be true about hated figures to this fringe. So the best example, of course, is there was a demand for it to be true that Barack Obama was not a US citizen, that he was a secret Muslim. When I say there was a demand, what I mean is lots of people wanted that to be true. They wanted that to be true. They wanted it to be a fact. Huge demand for that fact. The only problem was, it's not a fact. But we can get around that. How do we get around that? Well, we get around it because we now have a media system in which, literally, anyone is a publisher. And not just that, that open media system, which in a way is a good thing, of course, open system, right? Anybody can play, that's democracy. One of the key features of that system is that it's very good at registering demand for a fact that isn't true. Like all of the likes on Facebook and shares on Facebook that pile up. So this fringe element is a combination of very demand-sensitive writing and production, plus, this is the other element, extremely low standards of proof. So low that they don't even exist. So when you combine this demand-centric approach with extremely low standards of verification, meaning you don't care if there's any facts at all, and then combine it with an open system like Facebook or blogging or internet talk radio, where anyone can play, then it's very difficult to defeat that except through regulation, which would violate the First Amendment, right? So even when Facebook did something fairly responsible and said, we're gonna attach little stickers to stories that are fake and false, but spread on our platform to let you know, if you decide to share this story, that this has been fact-checked by factcheck.org and found to be false. And they did that in response to complaints like this. Before they announced that policy, they ran it by me, because I'm a professor who thinks about these things. So they kind of wanted to know, like, what would the reaction be if we did this? Something I do as a professor. So they were going to use for their stickers what they called third-party fact-checkers. Factcheck.org, PolitiFact, Washington Post fact-checkers, ABC News, AP. Right? These are the institutions that they were going to rely on for their stickers. So I told them, I think this is a responsible step. I think it makes sense to do it. I just want to tell you that within an hour of announcing this policy, the right wing will denounce your fact checkers as not fact checkers at all, but as another part of the liberal media. So the Facebook people said, well, we're not really worried about that because we are nonpartisan. That's what they said to me. We are nonpartisan. I said, well, that doesn't have anything to do with it. They're going to denounce you anyway. You'll see. And they go, well, you know, we'll be fine. So it didn't take an hour, it took 20 minutes. 20 minutes. And every single third-party fact-checker that Facebook signed up to do its checking was denounced by the right wing as the liberal media, not fact-checking at all, just another ideological apparatus, et cetera, right? So 20 minutes. So then I said to them, see, I told you. And they were like, it's cool, because what we're going to do is we're going to add to our six nonpartisan fact-checkers, we're going to have some conservative-leaning fact-checkers added to the mix. I said, good luck. Hope you find them. To this day, no one has been added to the mix because they couldn't find any. So, or if they approach them, they refuse to participate, which is even more interesting, right? So in an environment like that, it's very difficult to know what to do until we have enough people, enough Americans who tire of this system just as they're tired of breakdowns in Congress and start not just demanding something better, but themselves acting on something better than that. So we are right now at the mercy of demand. Until people start demanding real information for themselves and for the people they share information with, we're not going to get out of this cycle. I don't think there is a media solution to it. I think it's a behavioral problem. You know what I mean? Yes. Okay, this will be the last question.
Can we attend our coffee hour later?
No, I'm sorry, I can't. Just real quick, I think this young lady is very courageous. I find this to be a wholly partisan presentation. We had a professor here address Agora a few weeks ago, and whenever he made an example of the right, he would give an example on the left. I remember a slide where he showed Hillary or Bill with a Pinocchio nose. Nothing changes. It's not the Trump administration. The media has been marginalizing and smearing elected Republican presidents for a couple of decades. And when you look at one president that's called stupid, a Nazi, that was Bush, but never heard about Gore, who made more grades at the Ivy League school that they both attended, you're kind of omitting half the story. This presentation has been a wee day all about Republicans, but nothing about the Democrats.
I really did have to disagree with that.
Let me respond to that. The tendencies that I've talked about do exist on the left and the right. As I said,
I said,
politicians lie, politicians manipulate, that goes to the left, that goes to the right. All our previous presidents have said things that were factually unsupportable. What I tried to say was not that this is only happening on one side. What I tried to say several times was that this president is breaking with precedent that held for both Democrats and Republicans and doing things that bust Democratic norms that were observed by both parties. And there is an asymmetry to that picture that I think is true. Now, I understand a lot of people disagree with me about that, but that's the way I see it. This is an asymmetrical and unprecedented situation with President Trump, and that doesn't try to argue that the news media doesn't have a point of view. I think it does. The news media is mostly composed of people who lean liberal. That's true as well. Previous presidents have sometimes gotten a raw deal from the press. That's true as well. But there is something different going on today, and that was the point that I tried to make.
Regarding that, just to follow up to what you just said, you've not mentioned that, would you rather see a president like Trump than a president like Hillary, who in the leaked emails dependent on her audience.
Well, I don't think litigating the 2016 election in this room is a very smart idea, so I don't want to respond to that.
That was specific to your comment about the fact that Trump won't back down. It's a similar kind of line in that it's a manipulative.
Okay, well, I reject all comparisons between Trump and every other presidential candidate and every other president since the Cold War. I don't think they apply. That's my.